Alright, so 0.6 has just been released with a completely overhauled feature set, an improved feature set. That is, you have improved format support, you can map all of your RGB channels, but before I keep on talking here, I will just take the time to show you each of those important elements step by step. Alright, so one of the new features in 0.6 is that you are now able to map each of the RGBA channels separately to a layer set. So, over in QuickSave Maps, we have this new column over here which says Channel Replacement, which essentially allows you to compose your image out of layer sets. So over here, I have a red, green and a blue layer set which I want to plug in here. So all I have to do is say, okay, I want to map the red channel, and I type in here red for my layer set. I could do the same for the other two. And once that is done, I can click save and close. And just to show you what those layer sets look like, the blue is just a B, same for the green and the red. So, and if I was to save this now, it will go ahead and take what is in those layer sets and put them into the channels accordingly. So this should just take a second here. So once that is done, I can open up my logging editor, and you can see over here that is the map we just saved. I can open this map up in Photoshop, close the logging editor, and over in my channel editor I can see that yes, the B is in the blue, the G is in the green, and the R in the red, just as I mapped it before. And to come back to the thing here, of course I could also map my alpha channel into that as well, if the target format supports alpha. So over here I'm using TGA, so I can say, yes, I want to save alpha, and I want to plug in a layer set as well, and not just use the Photoshop transparency. Save and close, and if I was to save this again now, and you can see over here I can select any of the layer sets involved and hit my magic button, and it will go through and do the job. It will take the first map that uses this layer set. If you want to pick the exact map that you want to save, you can make a a separate layer set with the name over here specified as layer name, and then you can save those quickly from the front interface as well. So if I was to open up the map we just saved, close this down, you can see that we now also have the alpha channel available to us. So another new feature of QuickSave Maps is that you have more formats available to you. That is the more specialized DDS format and even the Creative format. For you who are using the CryEngine, you know that you have to use this intermediate format which will then be converted to DDS by the CryEngine itself, by the resource compiler. So this allows you to at least semi-quickly save your maps using this tool. And I'll just show you DDS for now. So if I open the format settings for DDS, it will ask me for a profile file. At the moment you can see it's none loaded. So if I click this here, I can choose one of the profile files I saved earlier using the DDS plugin for Photoshop. So I can say I want to use DXT5, accept this, save and close. And if I was to save this map now, it will save this map out and then convert it to DDS using the specified settings in this profile file. Right. So if I open up my logging editor, I can see DDS map has been saved. Close this down and yep, get my DDS file over here. So a few minor new features, which are also very handy, are interface features. So whereas before the interface was very rigid, you now have at least a little bit more control over what you want to do. So for example down here you could say how many maps you want to show per page. To demonstrate that, I'm just going to add a few empty maps. And then I could say, oh, I only want to show two, for example, because the dialog can get quite big, and then I can of course, as before, navigate through those pages. But what I can also do is I can move my I can move the order of my maps around. This is especially helpful if you are like here, if you were mapping all your RGBA channels, and if you were picking one of the RGB channels from the layer set while working and then hitting the magic button, it would take the first map that it finds. So if you want to work quick and you don't want to worry about it, make sure that the map that you want to save using those things here is at the top. So, yeah, so that's just those buttons over here. Right. Another new feature is that you can now easily instantiate one of your settings, duplicate, it's probably a more accurate term. So I could click this one over here and it will give me the same settings again, and I can make a derivative map of that. Also, if you have a huge number of maps configured, you'd go through here and pick those maps. The ones that say no name are the ones that I just quickly edit. But let's say I want to, work on the this one here, so I could click this map and it will go through the correct page, and I can do my settings over here. Alright, so another few minor additions are the scale options that you have. This means that whereas before you were only able to choose from full, half, quarter, or custom, that you can now say fixed, which allows you to specify the exact width and height in pixels. And on top of that, you're now able to specify a resampling method per map, which is sensible. Let's say you're saving a normal map, but you want to downsize it at saving time, but you want to use a different resampling method than you want to for your specular map or whatever. Which sure makes sense. So you could say, I want to use nearest neighbor for my normal map, but I want to use bcubic sharper or whatever for my specular map. And then another little addition, completely unrelated to scale, is to be found in the pre and post processing options over here. That is, you're now able to execute post processing options, post processing droplets in their own thread. This means that you can choose whether or not you want to wait for the post-processing option to be finished before the next map is saved, if you're doing a save a batch operation. If you say execute an on-thread, what it will do is it will launch the post-processing droplet, but it will not freeze Photoshop. You can still work on your stuff, so this is completely pipeline dependent, or depending on the post-processing droplet that you're using. So I hope that you find those new features helpful and that they will speed up your pipeline, and thank you for watching this.